Okay. So when the computer's connected, then the next speaker will be Mira Katwinkel. And actually, there's a distinct connection between them because you'll also be talking about networks, but you'll be talking about stream networks, and you'll be taking up one of the points which Robin made about the relationship between proprietary closed source code from ESRI, ArcGIS, which is involved in one R package which already exists, STARS, and you're opening it up, which will be interesting to see. I have to admit that I did review the SSN and STARS papers when the papers right. connected to the packages came out, so it's something I've know a little bit about.
Okay. Thank you. So can you hear me? Yeah. Hello, everybody. Thank you for staying so long. So we now move to a different kind of networks. My name is Mira Katwinkel. I work at the University of Landau in the group of quantitative landscape ecology. And in general, we deal with what anthropogenic stressors do in aquatic ecosystems. And particularly, we focus on pesticides. And I would like to talk about OpenSTARS. It's a tool to prepare GIS data for statistical analysis on stream networks. So it's quite specific, but I hope it's still interesting for you. So if we get monitoring data, maybe from the authorities, about the temperature, about chemical concentrations in streams, about macroinvertebrates, like, well, okay, these little guys on the right, or diatoms, or whatever we are interested in, we have only measurements at certain sites of our stream network. And what we typically want to do with such data is we want to assess somehow the impact of certain characteristics of the catchments of these measurement sites on what I have measured. So how does, for instance, landscape or agriculture impact the concentrations of pesticides that I measure? Or what is the impact of a wastewater treatment plant on the nutrients that are in the water? Things like that. And maybe we also want, if we have prepared a regression model, we would like to do predictions on sites where we don't have the measurements. And maybe also our task is, okay, we have a certain network of sampling sites and we would like to know, okay, if we have resources to install some new measurements or some new sampling sites, where do we learn most from? So where can we improve our statistical models the most with new data? And to do this in the correct way, we have to take into account, okay, this is spatial data, so there is some spatial autocorrelation in this data, and we should account for this in the correct way. So some basics, so typically, also, we often do this with the spatial data. We forget that they are spatial, and we just do, for instance, a linear model or whatever, so we have a dependent variable, concentration, or, presence, absence data of a certain species, and we have some predictors or covariates, and we would like to estimate the beta, so the coefficients, and there's an residual error involved, and this error has a distribution depending on the data, but what we always assume is that this error is independent and random. However, if we move to spatial data, of course, there's spatial autocorrelation or spatial correlation in this residual error, and we must take this into account. So the assumption is that closer measurements, so spatially closer measurements, are more similar to each other than measurements that are further apart. And when we work on this stream networks, we can ask ourselves, okay, is the Euclidean distance, is this really a good measure? This is what we would usually do in normal spatial statistics. So if we focus on the orange dot, okay, you cannot really distinguish this. If you focus on the bottom dot and measure the Euclidean distance to top dots, it's nearly the same, but if we are on such a stream network, it is clear that we have to go along the network if we want to compare the similarities or dissimilarities between the points. So then the one point to the left is really further apart from the bottom point compared to the other one. Then we have to ask ourselves, okay, how is this relationship? Is it only downstream? So if I am working with concentrations and the substances are transported by the river flow, then the relationship is certainly only downstream and the downstream measurement doesn't influence the upstream point. But if I'm working with animals who do some active migration that can migrate upstream, then maybe it's also sensible to take the upstream relationship into account. And then we can distinguish between two other sorts of relationships. So we can say, okay, there are two points that are flow connected, either in flow direction or against it, like the two blue dots. And there are other sites that are flow unconnected, so from which the flow goes into the same direction and they meet somewhere, but they, the water doesn't flow from one point to the other. And this is called flow unconnected. So these are the basics. These are some things we have to keep in mind. And then there are some clever people invented tools to deal with this spatial autocorrelation and to describe it in a correct way on river networks. So they came up with a moving average approach that gives you a valid covariance function called sigma on river networks. And there are various functions how you can describe it. So it could be linear or it could be curved. And when we then construct a regression model, we on the one hand estimate this autocorrelative function and at the same time estimate the coefficients for our regression model. So the relationship could look a little bit like this. So the dots are those sites that are flow connected with each other, so the red ones in the left-hand picture. And there you see that the farther they are apart, so on the x-axis is the distance, the more dissimilar they become. So that is what we would expect. And the same is true for the flow unconnected, so for the triangles, but they are even more dissimilar compared to the connected ones. And you see also that there are two different, fits. One would be a linear one and one could be like a curved one. This really depends on your data. Okay, so how do we do this then? There is a package called SSN, Spatial Stream Network, which creates this autocorrelation function, and you can estimate spatial linear, spatial mixed effect, and spatial generalized mixed effect models. And because we are dealing with spatial data, there's also a tool called STARS that helps you prepare all the data you need to really apply the statistics. However, it requires ArcGIS and the spatial analyst to be there. So I think this is one of the reasons why this method has not been picked up so strongly. So I had the idea to create an open source version of this data preparation called OpenStars. A few days ago, I updated the current version, and it is based on R and GrassGIS. Why GrassGIS? You can also find it on GitHub. And if you have some issues, just drop me a line there. So why did I choose GRASS for this? So it's connected with RGRASS 7. And one reason is that GRASS has this very strong location paradigm, so it forces you that all the data are in the same coordinate reference system. And if you have worked with spatial data, you know that this can be a pain in the neck. But there are some functions in the package that help you to import all the data into the same location. And so GRASS takes care about it, that it really has the same projection. Additionally, it has some really powerful tools to derive stream networks from a digital elevation model and to derive also the catchments that are things that you need for the analysis. There are functions to intersect raster and polygain data. And I try to be as consistent as possible in the package, so to use just one software, but I also use some functions from other spatial packages in R. So what does the workflow look like? So the first thing is to set up the GRASS environment that takes care about the region that we are looking at and takes care of the projection checks. Then you import the data that you're working in, so you import the digital elevation models and the points where the measurements were taken. This is mandatory, and additionally, you can also import potential explanatory variables, so potential covariates that can be raster or vector data, like the land use, the soil, geology, point sources, the slope, whatever. And you can also import a stream network that will be burned into the digital elevation model, and then the final stream network is derived. So this is the data, the digital elevation model. You have some points with the observations. The colors just indicate an arbitrary measured value. You maybe have a land use, and you have some, the black dots are some point sources, for instance. Okay, then the second step is that you really derive the stream network from the digital elevation model. And this function ensures that you really get a topologically correct network. So you get the information, which is the starting point of a stream segment, which is the end point, in what direction is the flow, what is the source, what is the outlet of the catchment. And the data then looks like this. It's called stored in an object called edges, and this has some data behind it. So every stream has an ID, and it knows its previous two streams. So these prefstr 01 and 02 are the two streams that flow into one segment, and the next, and it also knows into what is the next segment it flows into. And all the following calculations depend on that this information is available. And there's one additional function, because when you derive a stream network from a digital elevation model, you can get this so-called complex junctions. So you have more than two inflows into one outflow, and the SSN package cannot deal with this situation. So I included a function that like moves one of the three inflows just a little bit, like a fraction of the raster size of the digital elevation model, and yeah, corrects in this way the network a little bit so that the SSN can really work with it. Then the third step is to snap the sites to the streams. So if you have GPS coordinates of the sampling sites, it often occurs, like, I don't know if you can see this, like here, that the dot is not really, on the streams. So we want to snap, like drag the points on the stream network. And then you can start to intersect your sites with some covariates. And there are two ways to do that. So in the original STARS toolbox, there's an approximate way. So they calculate these values once for the segments, and then the sites are assigned the values of the segments they lay on. And I included a function to do this with the exact catchment. So this is the map. We are interested in the blue dot in the top. And if I zoom in a little bit, so we want to know, okay, what is the percentage of the different land use types of in the catchment? And if I do both calculations, so Agri A stands for agricultural approximate, and only Agri stands for agriculture land use in the real catchment, you see that for the approximate, I get about 30%, and for the exact, I get 60%. So this is quite an extreme value, because there's quite a difference, as you can see here. If you only look at the catchment, the amount of agriculture is quite high. But if you look at the stream bit where the point lies on, there's a lot of grassland, so this bluish, grayish color. So in most cases, the approximate calculation is good enough. But maybe there are cases where you should do the exact one, but it can really take a while. So I did this for the example. There are 60 points. It takes about 3 minutes on my computer. But if you have 100 or 400 measurement points, you have to intersect all the catchments. First, you derive the catchments for the point, and then you have to intersect them. So this can really take some time. Okay. The next step is maybe you want to create some prediction sites, so points where you want to do predictions for once you have your regression model, and you can choose on which part of the network you can do this, or how many sites you want to have, or how far apart they should be. So here I restricted the prediction sites to the upper part of this network. And finally, you export all the files you have created, or the objects you have created, to a so-called SSN object. So this is the data structure given by the SSN package that it is able to read in. Okay, these are all the points or the steps that are necessary to do an SSN regression. And I have a little application here. So we have water quality monitoring data, so on pesticides for Germany and France. On first, I did it for Germany. So on the x-axis, there's the distance between the points, and on the y-axis, there's the semivariance, so a measure of the dissimilarity of the data. And again, the blue dots are the flow unconnected ones, so those where we think they are more dissimilar, and the red ones are the flow connected ones, and you see that we don't see anything. So there seems to be no spatial correlation in this data. So it doesn't matter if it's unconnected or not, and it doesn't matter how far the points are apart, they are, it's just random. And the non-spatial model that I developed for the data has agriculture as the main driver for the number of detected pesticides, but the variance explained is very low. And for the France data, it looks a bit different. So here it's more like we would expect. So the red dots, the connected sites are more similar than the unconnected ones. And the further apart they go, the more dissimilar they are. So I fitted a GLM with Poisson errors. And again, land use is the main driver. And when I compare the spatial to the non-spatial model, the root mean square prediction error is a little bit better for the spatial one because we use more information from the other points. On the other hand, the ALC is a little bit lower, but this is what we would expect because we have to estimate more parameters because we also have to estimate the coefficients for the autocorrelation. So to wrap this up, OpenStars is an open source tool to prepare GIS data for network statistics, and it helps you to have the whole workflow just in one software, which is R. And it has some additional features or differences compared to this original toolbox. So this correction of the complex junctions is a little bit different. You can calculate exact catchment variables, and you can automatically create prediction sites, which was also not possible so far. I think you had to really click on like digitize points if you wanted prediction sites. Yeah, with this, I would like to thank you. And if you are interested and find a bug, drop me a line. Thank you very much.
Thank you. That was very interesting. I'm sure I could take about another half an hour to give some comments because it is really very. Every time you want to drink a glass of tap water, think about this work. A short question, or shall we move straight on?
Has it been used on road networks? Has it been used on road networks?
No, the problem with roads is, I think you could adapt it, but in roads you don't have a flow direction. And you have, like, crossing roads and...
In the morning, you do.
Could be an interesting application, yes.